Welcome, everyone, to the first joint Practical Defense Podcast and the Firearms Broadcast. Today, our hosts are me, Alex Addix, and Gail Bevan.
Hi, Alex.
Hey, this is going to be great.
This is. Welcome to the broadcast.
Thanks. I've got my high heels on today.
And they look fabulous.
Our amazing guest this week is Rossiella Tessius Tortorelli. Welcome.
Thank you. It's nice being here.
So let's start by going over your background. I'm going to let you explain that because it is amazing and varied and spans over three decades.
Well, I'll try to be brief. However, I've been in the martial arts for approximately 37 years. I started as a way of getting out of my house when I was 15 years old. I wanted to go and hang out with other kids, and I was allowed to go to church. And at this church, a priest asked if we could take a self-defense class. So we brought a Taekwondo instructor. I started taking classes there along with three or four of my brothers, and eventually they lost interest and I continued. And after that class ended, I ended up joining another local martial arts school. And as I started going up the ranks, one of the things that I noticed was that I never got to test what I was learning, meaning that in those days, this was in the early 70s, people were competing and we weren't allowed to. So as I continued to learn more about martial arts, I was already thinking that I wanted to teach one day, and I felt that how can I teach if I have no idea whether what I'm really made out of, whether I would buckle under pressure or whether I could apply what I was learning. So I started competing in what was called full contact karate at the time. It was a professional kickboxing.
Why did you go directly professional? Why did you do the amateur? I mean, I started the amateur tournaments, the local tournaments, the international, Edwards Internationals. Why don't you skip all that and go right to pro?
Well, these were not the tournament. This was full contact, the knockout. And the reason I did that was because, one, I didn't know the difference. I was in a small town. I was in Oxnard, and all we knew about was that there was full contact karate. And in full contact karate, or, you know, it's kickboxing, there was amateur. After fighting about three times amateur, and getting beat up and going, I'm doing this just for a piece of plastic, and other people were turning pro, myself along with a few other local fighters said, let's go pro, there's no big difference, except we might make $100 a round. So that was the reason I decided for the money, might as well, if I'm going to get hit, might as well get paid for it.
It's logical to me.
So I started actually...
But maybe, but not for $100.
Well,
The 70s,
$100 a round, if you think about it, and you had a 10-round fight, more in the boxing, that was
$1,000. Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't understand. It was $100 a round.
A round, so, yes,
okay,
yes.
$100 per person.
No. But actually, if I think about it, I was kickboxing first as an amateur, but as a professional, I became a professional boxer before I became a professional kickboxer, because there wasn't a lot of action for women. There was so few women competing in the 70s, and I had heard about a lady who I got to meet, train with, named Lily Rodriguez, she rest in peace, and she was a kickboxer, and she was also boxing. And at that time, I figured, well, boxing, all I have to do is keep my feet on the ground. And so it gave me more activity where I could maybe kickbox 1 month, a few months later, I could box. And what I learned was that I just really enjoyed the training and the excitement of you know, getting ready for a fight. So I started boxing, and it was kind of a fluke thing. And on July 13th, Friday the 13th, 1979, I became world champion in boxing by accident.
Yeah.
I say by accident because I was supposed to be a tune-up match for the world champion at the LA Sports Arena. It was a very special event because it was the first all-women's card that had been hosted at the Los Angeles Sports Arena. And her opponent injured herself, so they were quickly looking for a replacement. I'd never boxed professionally. So after they kind of doctored up my record and got me approved, I was able to fight that night. And I have to say the world champion retired. Not to sound arrogant, she retired that night, and I went in her place 2 weeks later to San Antonio, Texas, and defended the title in a 10-3-minute round fight, which went the distance. And that's how I became boxing world champion. And it wasn't until 2 years later that I actually fought for world title kickboxing.
How was that transition? Because growing up as a martial artist, whenever I tried boxing, I kept picking my leg up and wanting to kick. And I had such a hard time keeping my feet on the ground whenever I was sparring, trying to box with friends.
I never had problem, I guess, is it depends. Because you have, might have that problem because you were competing in tournaments. I never competed in tournaments. I had one fight that I would train for, no different than professional kickboxing or boxing today. The only time I was at Ed Parker's Internationals was to do a demonstration when I had an all-women's demo team. But I never competed in that circuit.
I don't seem to recall there being a lot of women's boxing in the 70s.
There was not a lot of women's boxing in the 70s. In fact, there was one. There was few women boxing, and also we were, I don't want to say treated so badly, but the love of fighting pushed us to put up with a lot. When I first started fighting, there were no weight divisions for women. We basically had very few rights. I mean, we were licensed. However, we couldn't ask for anything. I was considered a difficult boxer to work with because I was demanding getting paid $100 a round. And I had a trainer when I became serious about boxing. I thought I was, I went from Oxnard, Ventura County. I transferred to the University of UCSB, and I continued training on my own. As women boxers, we didn't have access to really good trainers because we weren't taken serious, number one. And there was just so few of us. There was, I mean, if we found other women to train with, most likely we would end up fighting that female. So you only trained with men. So when I became serious about it, I came from Los Angeles to the Olympic Boxing Gym, which no longer exists. You're probably aware of it. I started training there, and I was the only female on a boxing gym where there was 36 to 40 male fighters. So we put up with a lot of crap because it was, if you don't want to fight, well, hey, we don't need you. But yet we were exploited. We were used. We were paid very little. We weren't given contracts. We weren't given training money. This is being a world champion. However, if you looked at the posters, it was my picture on there, or I was the main event. But I wasn't getting paid anything. But if you complain, they say, hey, no problem, go away.
So the males would get paid.
Oh, the men did get paid. You could never, and I understood that women have not been boxing as long as men, so I didn't expect to get paid equal to a male world champion. However, it wasn't equitable, and it's still not equitable to this day.